I'm going to read verses 6 through 9. And from the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, today we're going to explore the idea of moving forward with God's help. Amen?
Yes.
Moving forward with God's help. In Joshua, chapter 1, beginning with verse 6, it says, "Be strong and of good courage. Unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from the right nor to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate on them day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in the book. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou wilt have good success. Have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage? Don't be afraid, don't be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Again, as you are seated, I want to talk about moving forward with God's help. My brothers and sisters, all of us experience times in life when we want to move forward and are unable to. Some would like to move from discouragement to hope. Some would like to move from depression to well-being. Some would like to move from anger to forgiveness. Some would like to move from anxiety to peace. Some would like to move from stress to rest. Some would like to move from grief to comfort. Some would like to move from trials to victory. Some would want to move from loneliness to relationships. Others may want to move from addiction to freedom. But whatever it is, we all are wanting to move forward. And my brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that whenever we want to embark on something new, we need to understand that God is a God of transition.
Amen.
God is a God of movement. As we read the Bible from cover to cover, we see that we do not serve a static God.
Amen.
He is a God who is on a journey, and a purposeful journey. And God has us on a moving forward journey. And so, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand, my brothers and sisters, that so many of us, like the children of Israel, are still hanging out in places that God has already passed. The fact of the matter is, God has called us to be his disciples, to be followers of him. But so many of us would rather remain in memories, would rather remain in places where God has already moved forward. And I want you to understand something, that none of us can move forward in our own strength. As a matter of fact, you could not even move forward to accept God on your own. You had to receive some unction from the Holy Spirit to get you to come forward. And so even in your Christian life, in order for you to move forward from whatever it is that you may be experiencing, whatever may be troubling you, you need to understand you can only move forward with the help of God.
Amen.
The Bible calls us literally to move or live from faith to faith, to move or live from trust to trust. And understand, God is always requiring and calling upon us to not simply trust him for yesterday's victory. God wants us to trust him for today and tomorrow's victory. Listen, our faith must be put in action, not simply as a memory, but faith must be renewed and energized day after day after day. So the question comes, Pastor, we want to move forward from discouragement to hope, from depression to well-being and everything that you've mentioned, but we simply don't know how. But listen, the Bible gives us answers to whatever it is that perplexes us. The Bible tells us that we can move forward by faith. Listen, as a means of painting a scene that is very clear, Our text rests at a point of transition in the Bible. Please understand, as we look at the first five books of the Bible, particularly called the Torah or the Pentateuch, the first five books of Moses, Joshua serves as a transition book for a number of reasons. First of all, the book of Joshua is the first book of the Bible that bears a proper name. It's the first book that bears the name of an individual, and that's not by happenstance. It indicates that God is moving forward in his journey and with his dealings with his people. It transitions the children of Israel from the time of the patriarchs to the time of Joshua. And many of us, if we were given a quiz or an exam on this individual by the name of Joshua, I really don't know how much biographical information we would know about Joshua, but we need to understand that Joshua stands as one of the greatest persons of faith in all of human history. Philip Keller says that Joshua seldom has been given full credit he deserves as perhaps the greatest man of faith in the Bible. As a matter of fact, he says when we look at Joshua and his moment on the stage of human history, he says Joshua's entire brilliant career was a straightforward stand of simply setting one foot in front of another in quiet compliance to the commands of God. You will find that Joshua never deviates from the commands of God. When God tells Joshua to go or do, Joshua never hesitates. Now let me compare Joshua to Moses, because there were times when Moses' life, when Moses vacillated. He wasn't sure if God was calling him. He wasn't sure if God wanted him to go. He wasn't sure sometimes if God was going to turn the people around. But when you look at Joshua, you'll find that Joshua never vacillated. When God said, go, God, Joshua went. When God said, send him into the Jordan and get 12 stones, Joshua did it. Joshua was a tremendous man of faith who is not given credit for being a man who took one step at a time, trusting the commands of God. Francis Schaeffer says that Joshua is a bridge book. Francis Schaeffer says it's a transition book. The first major part of the book deals or reminds us that while situations in our life change, God never changes. That's why this scene paints a very vivid picture, because within, my brothers and sisters, the children of Israel are within a stone's throw of the promised land. But the writer begins with the words, after the death of Moses. The reason why it begins is because it's reminding us that life is always in flux. Life is always in transition. We're always moving from one stage to another. But even though life is changing, even though circumstances are changing, our God's purpose still remains the same. And sometimes God has to remind us that he is in control and not man. Oftentimes we can be following man and not God. Often we can be walking not by faith, but we can be walking by sight. Sometimes we can think that we brought water from the rock, that we brought manna from heaven. Sometimes we can think it's all about us. And so listen, the Bible reminds us by opening this book, this transition book, saying, Moses is no longer here, but my purpose is still going to take place. And listen, whatever you may have lost in life, and whatever you may be afraid to move forward from, understand, God has a purpose for your life. Listen, the promised land, whatever it is in your life, you may have lost some things, but God is still carrying you forward. But you got to trust God one step at a time. There may be tears in your eyes, but step and trust God. You may be afraid, but step and trust God.
and trust God. You might not be able to see it, but step and trust God. It may be mysterious and dark, but step
and trust God. Listen, all of us have a Moses, but Moses is gone. Moses served a purpose, but God has a greater purpose. And these words are not here by coincidence, but by divine plan. And understand, even with them, it is with us. Nothing in our life is by coincidence. It is all by divine plan. Words say after the death, literally, of Moses, not by accident, but by providence, the writer succinctly and intentionally begins the book with these words. They're inserted in order to help us realize that they move from one phase to another. But there's also another hidden meaning, problem that also arises with us as we begin to trust and we get to trust God to move forward. It reminds us, my brothers and sisters, just like the children of Israel, they had begun to look to Moses instead of God. Sometimes God has to remove our crutches in order to remind us that he is still in control. It never ceases to amaze me that believers who are called to walk in victory, we get used to walking on the crutches of man. But listen, my brothers and sisters, the crutches of man's wisdom can never take you where God's guidance can take you. And I'm sure the children of Israel must have been disturbed after the loss of Moses. I'm sure they began to sing that same old song, "What are we going to do now?" You know, I don't know why that hymn never made it into the Baptist hymnal. But somebody need to write it. What us? What are we going to do now? But the fact of the matter is that we ain't going to do nothing. We're going to trust God. You know, while we trying to figure some stuff out, God has already worked it out. And listen, so many of us, we've gotten bachelor's degrees and master's degrees and PhDs in worry. Listen, a whole lot of us could write a dissertation on worry. But God wants some folk who can write a book on trust. Somebody talk to me here today. See, you got to turn some stuff over to God, because God has moved forward. And God is trying to get us to go too. But we want to major in trusting in stuff instead of trusting in God. Listen, the psalmist said, "I've heard you say, trust in the Lord and do good, dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Trust also in him, and God will bring it to pass." Too often we are stuck in a moment that God has literally already passed. Listen, my brothers and sisters, the Lord says, listen, Moses is gone. Now he says, "I want you to get up and arise." So listen, in order to move forward, first thing you got to realize and understand that God has already moved forward. And stop relying on the crutches of the past. Listen, a lot of the wounds and scars of our past are really already healed. We just like to keep going through the museum of misery. Punching the ticket, somebody talk to me. Keep paying admission. But God is saying we've got to move forward. Now listen, he says, Moses is gone. Get up and arise. Because the Bible says it came to pass. Now the four words "it came to pass" are some of the most mysterious words in the Bible. "It came to pass" means it happened and I don't know how. But yet it's in the Bible. It came to pass. I don't know how I moved from stress to rest, but it came to pass. I don't know how I moved from depression to feeling free, but it came to pass. I don't know how I moved from my addiction to walking in freedom, but it came to pass. I don't know how I moved from loneliness to relationships, but it came to pass. I don't know how I moved from grief to comfort, but it came, listen, to pass. And whatever has you paralyzed at a moment in time, if you try
trust in God. It will. It shall. It must. Come.
God spoke to Joshua and the children of Israel and said, Moses, my servant is dead. In other words, Moses is gone, but move on. That which you used to depend on is gone, but move on. Get up from your mourning. I know Moses is not here, but move on. I know you love that job, but I got a better job for you. Listen, understand, oftentimes those things and people we serve will disappear, but the master never does. Don't focus on the servant. Focus on the master. Don't focus on the thing. Focus on the God. Notice in verse 5, Lord says, listen, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. I'll not abandon, nor will I ever fail to help you. In verses 6 through 9, God gives 10 twin commandments to Joshua, and by through Joshua to the children of Israel. Twin commandments are these: be strong and be of good courage. The interesting thing, these twin commandments are given 3 times. Be strong and of good courage, twin commandments that God gives 3 times. The natural order of reading the Bible, when we see repetitiveness, that implies that somehow it must be very important. As a matter of fact, when you say something more than one time, it's obviously very important. 3 times the Lord says, be strong and of good courage. At the beginning of verse 6, God says, be strong and of good courage. At the beginning of verse 7, he says, only be thou strong and very courageous. And finally in verse 9, God says, have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. You know, God has given us the same promises over and over again. And we often wanted God to give us something new. And we ain't trusted the promise he gave us yesterday. Listen, God knew the children of Israel and how they were. So he told them 3 times, be strong and of good courage. Only be thou strong and of good courage. And I know you're going to forget. So have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Listen, there are 3 reasons why God said be strong and of good courage. And then I'll be ready to sit down. Listen, God said if you're going to move forward in my help, you got to be strong and of good courage because I promised it to you. You know, oftentimes we can be trying to find some eloquent points from the text, but you've got to let the text speak for itself. The only way you can rightly divide the word of truth is not trying to come up with something new and stressful. Give them what the text says so it'll have an impact on their life. The Bible is not meant to be impressive. It's meant to be impactful. The Bible says be strong and of good courage because I promised it to you. You know, our motto is promises are made to be broken. But the fact of the matter is, that's not God's motto. God's motto is promises are made to be kept. And I want you to understand, you won't find any promise in the Word of God that God will not keep if you won't trust him. You got to be like Joshua and live day one step at a time, trusting literally in God. You'll never find God looking for an excuse as to why one of his promises did not come to pass. Because God has promised us the same thing he's promised all in the Word of God. In Genesis chapter 17, verses 7 and 8, God says, and I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed, and after thee and all generations for an everlasting covenant. And so we see in the book of Joshua that God is simply bringing his promise to pass. I know many of you, God says, are still upset about the fact that Moses is not here. But the promise is still in front of you. And my brothers and sisters, the promise is, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Not only can we move forward with God's help because of God's promise, we can also move forward and be of good courage, be strong and of good courage because God said, I've given you my word. Understand that God's word is wrapped up in God's promises. That's why God tells Moses, observe my law. Meditate on it day and night. Turn not to the right nor to the left. In other words, I want you to be hemmed in by my word. We often sing and celebrate about being surrounded, and we want to plead that the blood of Jesus be all around us. But listen, the blood ain't going to be around you if you don't know the word. Because the blood is found in the word. Somebody talk to me. He said, observe my word. Turn not from the right nor the left. Don't let it depart out of your mouth, but meditate on it day and night. Listen, God is saying and giving some very pivotal advice. The bus you take will dictate the road you travel. And so, if the bus come by with stress on the front, and you keep getting on the bus, stop wondering when the bus stops why you ain't at a place of rest. Somebody talk to me here today. Whatever you choose to get on is where you're going. Proverbs 3, 1 through 6, my son, do not forget my law, but let thy heart keep my commandments. Length of days, long life and peace they will give unto you. But then he says, thirdly, be strong and of good courage, because I'll go with you. Listen, he said, I promised you, I gave you my word. Be strong and of good courage, because I'll go with you. And my brothers and sisters, there are literally three stories in the Bible that remind us that God will go with us, that God's word is true, and that God's promises will come pass. In Numbers 13 and 14, God told them to take 12 spies to go spy out the land. Some individuals went, 12 spied out the land. 10 of them came back, said it looked good, but there are some giants in the land. But Joshua and Caleb came back and said there may be giants in the land. But God promised it in his word, and we're not going to be afraid. Paul said, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a sound mind. King Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles 20, Bible says that the Syrians and those in Moab and Ammon, they were coming against the children of Israel, and they sent a secret note to Jehoshaphat. And a whole lot of us, we get so scared of secret notes. Somebody talk to me here today. Jehoshaphat got scared because he knew they were coming. But in his fear, he said, we're going to lift our eyes to God and worship God. And as he began to worship God, God did something very mysterious. He didn't call the Department of Defense. He said, King Jehoshaphat, don't call the Department of Defense. I want you to call the Department of Praise. A whole lot of us will be trying to get all of our weapons of mass destruction together when we see the enemy coming. But God said, no, get the priests, the Levites, and the singers. And I want you to put them out front. Wait a minute. Listen, choir. They put the singers in front and those with the weapons behind. Listen, the Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty to the pulling. Listen, there's a song on your heart that can disarm your anxiety. There's a praise on your lips that can disarm your pain. You can banish doubt and fear by lifting your voice and praising God. Amen. In 2 Kings chapter 6, Elisha and the people of Israel were afraid because the Syrian army had set up an ambush. And the Bible says that their numbers were very small. But I want you to understand, if God is whittling everything around you, that's only because God wants to get the praise through you. God said, look up and you'll notice that those who are with us are more than those who are within. Listen, if God be for us, he's more than the world against you. If God is on your side, it doesn't matter what's coming your way. God is greater. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And my brothers and sisters, Jesus did not look like a formidable victor when he was suspended on that cross. As a matter of fact, And I've said it over and over again. You've got to understand, it was a homeless man who was telling the world. He said, foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. But a homeless man said, I go away to prepare a place for you. How a homeless man going to prepare a place? Y'all not going to talk to me now. He said, I ain't got no way to lay my head, but I'm making you a mansion. Open door. If a homeless man can make you a mansion, he can provide your needs on this earth. Trust in God. Come what may. God will take care of you. Jesus did not look like a formidable victor on that cross. But when he died, the world knew that God was our ultimate victory. And so my brothers and sisters and Christian friends, you can only move forward with the help of God. And that move forward comes with the unction and push of the Holy Spirit. If you're in your seat today, and I'm going to ask everyone to stand, and you feel the tug of the Spirit moving you forward, but yet there's reluctance. As I shared with the children, you're probably thinking, I'm just not good enough to go down yet. There are some things that I need to work out in my life, and I'll come forward next Sunday. Listen, you may work that out, but something else is going to come up. Amen? Move forward. And you can only move forward with God's help. We extend this invitation to Christian discipleship for you to become a follower of Jesus. Amen. Make Christ your Savior. If you have Christ as Savior, make First Baptist your church home. We would so love to have you. The doors are open. The deacons and ministers and I are ready to receive you.